We are now joined by Dr. Saskia Ossendarp, who has just put out such a thought-provoking piece that I read about the impact of COVID-19, particularly upon diets, upon maternal, child, undernutrition, the exacerbation of that, and indeed child mortality in low and middle-income countries. I just want to turn to your incredible research, Doctor, and really about what stood out to me was the year 2020, world hunger hit a 15-year high. One in 10 people are basically undernourished at the moment. How has COVID-19 worsened that situation?
Yes, thank you. And thank you for having me here and to have me speak about this important topic that's really affecting millions of mothers and children around the world. So what we were concerned of is that COVID is really affecting hunger and malnutrition at three different levels. It's affecting health systems because they are overburdened due to the COVID pandemic, and that is affecting the delivery of essential nutrition and health services, such as antenatal care services and early child care services. It's affecting food systems, which leads to food prices to increase and is particularly affecting the availability and the affordability of nutritious foods, again, especially for the vulnerable poor. And it's, of course, having an impact on an unprecedented impact, I should say, on incomes and on jobs and incomes to fall. And that has led to increases in poverty. And I think the World Bank estimated that in 2020, an additional 155 million people were pushed into poverty. So, yes, this has led to 3 billion people worldwide that cannot afford a healthy diet. And what's even worse is that the pandemic has made that income gap even bigger. And in addition, we know that it is then having an effect on malnutrition of children and mothers as well. So in order to estimate these effects, we brought together experts from nutrition, from food systems, from health systems, and economists. Yeah. We brought them together in a consortium, a Standing Together for Nutrition consortium, to model what these crises would mean for child and maternal malnutrition across the world, because we knew that this was going to be an unprecedented crisis.
I mean, 3 billion people unable to afford healthy food is shocking and extraordinary. Can you just bring together some of the statistics, some of the data that you, with that modelling technique, you brought to bear? What does this mean from an economic standpoint, from a personal standpoint?
Yes. So from a personal standpoint, we know from the modeling that by 2022, this pandemic could cause an additional 13.6 million children under the age of 5 to become wasted or acutely malnourished or having, you know, being too thin for their height. And that will have an immediate impact on their lives because it's affecting their immune response. But it will also have longer term impacts on their brain development, on their performance in school, and on how they will, the incomes that they will earn as an adult. And that will lead to economic productivity losses. So we have also estimated that the pandemic has a losses in social capital and human capital of at least $44.3 billion in the years to come. And the losses of life are devastating as well. We know already that every day an additional 6,000 children die of malnutrition before COVID. And the COVID pandemic will raise this number. And we will see an additional 283,000 children under the age of 5 dying due to malnutrition by 2022. And that's an equivalent of an additional 258 children every day due to this crisis. So these losses of life and the economic impacts are really, we have never seen that basically for decades. So we are really losing progress that we have seen happening over the last 10, 20 years.
Those numbers are so deeply sobering to feel that more than 250 children are dying unnecessarily each single day.
Yes.
What is the necessity that we need to do now in terms of realigning the food supply to ensure that supply chains are getting easier to navigate so that fresh food can get to the children, to the mothers, to the families that need it?
Yes. So our first message is really that we need immediate responses. Given the immediate losses of life that are at stake, So we must urgently address these nutritional needs of vulnerable communities worldwide, and particularly, again, of mothers and children. And that's why nutrition investment must be integrated into COVID-19 response and recovery plans. We cannot wait for the pandemic to be over, because this generation of children cannot wait. An entire generation is at stake. And for the longer term, we also need investments, structural investments, improving food systems and health systems, so that we can make sure that more children and more families have access to nutritious foods and diets. And that's why the UN Food Systems Summit that will take place in September, but where we have a pre-summit taking place in Rome this week, is so critical, because that's where multiple stakeholders will come together and they'll make commitments and pledges for nutrition, because we do also need more money to be able to make these structural investments in food systems and health systems, and to be able to deliver these essential nutrition services, such as vitamin A supplementation, such as the promotion of breastfeeding, such as some of those very high on return micronutrient investments, interventions, including fortification, biofortification, micronutrient supplementation for pregnant women, and we need to increase the investments in nutrition,
Doctor.
But we also,
Doctor Ossendorp, can you give us an example of how that supply chain can be smoothed out? What is it? You say you need the investment, the money to put to work. What would it exactly fix that's lacking right now?
Yeah, so what it will fix is it will fix the access to nutritious foods. So what is lacking now is that poor people don't have the means financially, but also in education-wise, to get the access to nutritious foods. And COVID has kind of increased that. So we know that in order for them to get this access, social protection programs, for instance, need to include nutrition. They need to include vouchers or other cash transfers to give these people access to foods. We also need to make it easier for them to have access to these essential services that are normal for you and me. When we are pregnant, we have access to good quality antenatal care. We have access to the extra additional supplements that we need for adequate growth of our babies, and and when our babies are older, we know that they are being monitored for their growth, and if they become malnourished, they're being detected and treated, and all these services now have been disrupted due to the pandemic, and in some cases because the health systems are overburdened due to COVID and COVID patients, they will not be able to recover anytime soon.
What countries are we talking about here, Doctor?
So these are particularly issues in low and middle income countries, and we've seen now that this year the COVID pandemic has really accelerated in many of these countries, with second waves happening in South Asia, and now you see it happening in different African countries, and these were countries that had already very high malnutrition numbers before COVID. So they are at increased risk now for these additional malnutrition cases.
Do you feel that people are aware of this issue, that you say the stakeholders are coming together, the right stakeholders, the right, whether it be members of, whether it's politicians locally or internationally, and whether it's indeed the overall healthcare providers, whether they be private, whether they be public, and indeed whether they be charitable and not-for-profit. Do you think that they're aware and is work at play already?
Yeah, so I'm reasonably optimistic, because what we did see this week is that in the UN Food Systems Pre-Summit, a Zero Hunger Nourish the Future pledge was announced, in which is a proposal for private sectors, and they've aligned up to $5 billion of collective investments into new evidence and into nutrition interventions, and which is an important step forward to eliminate child hunger, and it's part of a zero hunger movement that is really accelerating now. And we do have another summit coming up, which is the Nutrition for Growth Summit in December this year in Japan, where again, stakeholders, governments, private sector, international NGOs, everyone is stepping up and making commitments. So slowly, slowly, the recognition is definitely there. Yeah. But it needs continuous attention, of course, particularly with all the other effects of the pandemic affecting people's lives. Yeah. But what we know is at stake here is an entire generation, because malnutrition early in life is really affecting the future of this generation of children, but also of the next generation of children due to the longer-term effects.
Dr. Ossendub, what about private sector role here? When you say $5 billion, that sort of money pales into comparison when you not only think of the trillions being spent in developed nations on resuscitating economies, when we think of just what, you know, large businesses make on a quarterly basis, let alone an annual basis. We're in the middle of earnings season. Some of the tech giants are making far more than that on a quarterly basis in terms of revenue. So $5 billion, how much is that in terms of what you really think is needed? And how much are we starting to see private sector being able to bring in the efficiencies perhaps needed within the public sector too?
Yes, it's a very, very good first step. And we need commitments from all parties involved, including, of course, the United Nations agencies, including governments, including donor countries, because we know that there has been a report coming out before COVID, which was by Cirrus 2020 report, that estimated that an additional $33 billion US dollars is needed to really every year to end hunger. Mm. So yes, $5 billion US dollars will be an important contribution, but we will need more investments in order to end hunger by 2030.
One thing that you need to happen right now to really shift this movement to ensure that that $30 billion of lost productivity, those 250 children a day aren't losing their lives, what's one thing that you'd like to see?
One thing that I like to see is to have commitments from governments that they include investments in direct nutrition interventions as part of the COVID-19 response planning, because that's what they are discussing and negotiating now during meetings in the as part of the Food Systems Summit of the United Nations that's taking place, but also as part of other discussions that are going on at the World Bank. So that's what we really need now.
Saskia Ossendub, Dr. Saskia Ossendub, fascinating talking to you, an amazing piece of research that you've done with other colleagues, and we thank you for shining a light on it for us.